Hello, hello, hello. We are TNC The Premix, back for episode 20. Yes.
20 episodes. 2-0. The haters and doubters, of which there were many, said we couldn't even get to episode 5. And here we are, glowing.
And the 5 people that listen to this, we thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Please quit harassing me about what I say on this. I get forgetful.
Episode 20 brought to you by realestate605.com. And Tyler, would you like to highlight a broker associate for us, please?
I have the perfect broker associate for any of the listeners. We are talking about my pal, Reed Johnson. Reed believes in customer service above all else, and he believes that every client deserves his full commitment and loyalty from the beginning stages to the closing and beyond. For more than 29 years, Reed has been listing and selling homes in Sioux Falls as a realtor and an investor. Mm-hmm. His knowledge, his experience, his integrity, and his excellent negotiating skills to his clients, they have earned him the trust and respect of his clients and peers. Reed Johnson, the Swiss Army knife of selling real estate in the 605 in the Sioux Falls area. I recommend you give him a call. Maybe you shout out TNC The Premix. He'll probably know what we're talking about.
Yeah. Like Tyler said, if you want to get a hold of Reed or look at everybody else from the team or just get in touch and talk some real estate and see what your options are and talk it over with them about your housing and possible renting or selling, buying, listing, whatever. Stop by again at realestate605.com. And with that, let's get into it.
Let's go. Bang, bang, bang. Dude, how's it going?
Not too bad. What's going on with the head?
I'm losing situation? My mind. It is 4,000 degrees outside, and I can't stop sweating.
You look like a camel salesman.
That's what I was going for. This is a t-shirt wrapped around my head. Like, I'm not going to say the word, but a traditional Middle Eastern head wrap. I look like Yasser Arafat. And if you don't know who that is, Google him. That's the look I'm going for. We live in the fucking desert, apparently. It is 3,000 degrees outside. I've had myself a day. And this is what I wanted to wear on the podcast.
How was your day, Tyler?
My Tuesday, Cody, has been slightly better than a Monday. Because Monday, some bad things happen too. But today was no bueno for your boy. The air conditioning broke in our office, which would be bad during normal times. Today, when it was 97 degrees outside, instantly became the biggest problem I've ever tried to overcome in my life. It was 87 fucking degrees in the office. 87 degrees. It's a fucking sauna. I had a mild breakdown where I might have thrown a couple temper tantrums because I was not having a good day already. I was sweating profusely. I was like dripping sweat, sending emails like a fucking Gatorade commercial. I was dying. And I eventually just broke down. I went out into the warehouse. The warehouse is, it's cooled, but it's not like Arctic cold, but it's right around like 65 degrees. I went out into the warehouse. I put a fan directly on me and I moved all my little computer and all my little phone. I moved that out to the office and I sat in the cool dark office or the cool dark warehouse for about 4 hours. I reacted poorly. I'm sure I'll get a stern email tomorrow reminding me about proper office etiquette. I will immediately delete that email. I might have threatened a couple air conditioning repairmen if they didn't fucking show up today. So, yeah, we'll see how this plays out. And let's cap this off with, on Monday, it was also hot, but I had AC. I was working hard. But since we're in a little bit of a busy season, there was some pizza brought to the office. Like, hey, you guys are working hard. Maybe you eat some pizza and we recover. Now, I'm not going to say where this pizza came from. Let's just say it came from a gas station. Rhymes with Racy's. And I had two slices of this pizza. And it fucking cut through me like a hot knife through butter. So Monday was capped off by a very long day with me having what can only be described as the loosest bowels this side of whatever porn star we're talking about nowadays, because I was fucking ruining toilets every like 3 minutes. I couldn't do anything. I couldn't walk. Like, I was debilitated and I just wanted to go home and they wouldn't let me. So the one bathroom, I just was running to the bathroom like every 3 minutes. And it was just hot liquid sad. And it fucking sucked. This whole fucking week, 0 out of 10. I fucking hate the heat. I hate it. I'm losing it. I got a goddamn head wrap on. I'm also icing my ankle because there was a tragic incident last week that will not be talked about. It definitely didn't occur at work, if you're a work comp person. And I definitely wasn't engaging in horseplay. And I definitely didn't think I tore my Achilles tendon. I have an ice pack wrapped in sweatpants pressed against the back of my Achilles tendon right now. And I'm fucking losing it, dude. Episode 20, the whole world's falling apart, and it's taking me with me. It's taking it with me. Taking me with it? There we go.
Taking you with it.
Yeah. Nailed it. Yep. Got it.
You're clearly distraught. wearing a majority of your laundry on your person right now.
Let me just paint a picture for you people at home right now. I am wearing a bro tank, shorts that I took from my friend Michael, one pair of women's socks, an ice pack on my Achilles tendon, and a long sleeve t-shirt wrapped around my head. And also I am rocking a fresh spray tan. You can't really see it right now, but I'm tan as fuck, people. That's right. Your boy got a spray tan.
Nice.
I look nice. Beautiful.
I always thought that it was weird. When you brought up having Mike shorts, I always thought it was weird when like girls would like exchange clothes and stuff. And guys don't do that in the same way necessarily. It's more like if an article of clothing gets left somewhere.
Yep.
And then it just kind of, you know, just finds its way into your pile of clothes and then you wash it and then it's just kind of like yours until it can be returned. I had a similar experience when I left my 2008 Miller High School football shirt that had my last name on the back of it. And then Freet had it and let's just say when I was in high school, I don't know if they did this at your high school, but when like chicks liked you, you would like let them wear like your football shirt or something like that that had your name
Hell
on the back.
Yeah.
I didn't have a lot of girls lining up to wear my jersey or wear my shirt with my name on the back. So when Freet was wearing it, I believe he still has the shirt to this day. Yeah. Like deep down, it kind of made me feel like proud that Freet wanted to wear it. So.
I got the prettiest girl at the ball wearing my shirt. Yeah, no, that's exactly how, like, yes, there's just random articles that, like, you know, your friend takes a sweatshirt off at your house. Like, you're running out the door and you're like, oh, shit, I need a sweatshirt. You see it sitting there, you grab it. That just becomes yours. These shorts, I had to, a couple weekends ago, there was a party at my friend Michael's house, Michael and Cam's house, and Jay Will. There was a party. I was wearing cut-off khaki pants because I'm just a walking white trash nightmare right now. And I was like, fuck, I would really like a pair of shorts. And Michael was like, oh, here you go. They're just mine now. They're just mine.
That's how it works.
And you know what? I'm not going to apologize. They're very comfortable. And they're allowing for a lot of breathability, which is what I need right now. The baby, the gold powder. What am I thinking of? Why am I drawing a blank? Gold Bond. Whew.
Ooh.
The Gold Bond I'm rocking right now. Not the flavor I typically go with, which is the mentholated kind. This is like some oatmeal Gold Bond. I don't know. I'm rating it a good 0 out of 10.
Mm.
I was a panic move. I got out of the shower and I was like, I need something for this. And it's what I had close.
I did slap on some monkey butt powder, just kind of powdered the boys this morning. Yeah, this is like the hottest it's been this year thus far, at least in my experience. Like when I came back from North Dakota yesterday and I got in and like my pickup was saying like 100 degrees when I like got in yesterday. And I literally was probably outside for like, I don't know, 15 or 20 minutes. And I had a bro tank on and like I sunburnt the back of my neck and like my shoulders. Like wasn't out there hardly at all, but most of the time I'm always in like a long sleeve shirt, like FR shirt for work. So my body doesn't see the sun. And I'm very like pasty Scandinavian fair skin.
Oh yeah.
So
freckles. A lot of freckles up in these shoulders.
Yeah, the sun cuts me. Cuts me deep. Yeah.
That's why I the whole last 2 days have not been good for me. In between the poops, the heat, everything's bad. But yeah, I was wearing just a t-shirt today, and it was one of those like I don't know how to describe it. It's like one of those soft t-shirts, if that makes sense. Like kind of like the thinner material. And I absolutely crushed that t-shirt. Thank God I had a spare t-shirt in my car, because I had to swap that out. And I was not working hard enough to have to swap on a t-shirt. That's for goddamn sure. And yeah, I am not a fan of the fucking heat. Every year this happens, I forget that it gets hot. Much like in 3 months, I'll forget that winter happens. Like, and it just totally takes me by surprise. So like, I walked out this morning and it was already like 75 degrees, and I was like, the fuck is this? And yeah, no, I'm not doing well. Give me like a 2 week adjustment period, and I should be okay. But I'm going to be flipping out for the next 2 weeks. I'm like when a dog, like, you know how like a dog, when the seasons change, like loses its winter fur and goes to its summer coat. That's basically what I'm doing right now.
Yeah. Our dogs are like mulching. Like it's really bad. We have a 150-pound German Shepherd, which German Shepherds are not supposed to be that size. He's enormous. He's also becoming a giant fat ass. But he's shedding like a motherfucker. And Pete is our Great Pyrenees. He's probably like 145. So we got 300 pounds of dog that are just shedding like an absolute son of a bitch in the house.
That's a
so
bunch of beefcakes. Yeah.
Yeah.
God, I identify with that 150-pound German Shepherd so much right now. I'm just... I'm a little bit pudgy right now. I'm constantly just like running around clawing at doors. I don't quite know what's happening, but I don't like it. And you know what? I don't care. I just don't care anymore. I want it to not be fucking hot, though. Is there just a place in the world where it's like 72 degrees, just like year round?
I don't know. I don't know. There's got to be some place that has like a mild climate. I think if you go to like a mountainous place, because my, I got a buddy, shout out my buddy Ryan from Wyoming. He lives like by like Jackson Hole or Jack, everybody just calls it Jackson. So where all the cool kids are.
I was going to say, sounds cool. I want to go.
He hates it when you say that, cause it's like a lot of Wyoming is obviously like rural and like
rural.
I don't even know how to describe it, but like a lot of the hot, cool kids live in Jackson and they go there snowboarding and skiing and stuff. But to circle back to my main point is that like none of those fuckers have air conditioning in their house.
I'd die.
Because like in the summertime when it gets like kind of warm, they just like open the windows. And because they're like in the mountains or whatever, it's typically like
they have a nice cool breeze.
Yeah, because like I don't know, I got heat stroke a couple times when I was like a younger man, and if I start getting too hot, I'll just start getting migraines and just start puking everywhere.
Yeah. I say I'm not made for these temps. That's just 100% what it is. I sweat far too easily, and that's not just me being pudgy. Like that's just like an affliction my family has. We're sweaters. My dad, not pudgy at all. That motherfucker moves. He's sweating. So if you introduce me to just a little bit of an out of my comfort zone client or like temperature, I'm perspiring.
I never used to be much of a sweater. But when I like in 2011, I was like 189 pounds. I am now like 265 pounds. So that might have something to do with it. I'm not a scientist. but like I will just be standing, sitting, whatever, and yeah, like I can just sweat just breathing now, and you add this 100 degree temperature, and if I'm trying to like do anything outside, it's just completely drenched in sweat.
I know I shout out my working career at Target. I know I did that last episode, but the first day I like worked there, they put me on cashier, and I was wearing, you know, whatever, like the Target red, but then I had like an undershirt underneath it. And the combination of, I was right by the door, so the door kept opening and the heat was blowing in, cause this is like the end of summer. So it's like August. So the door kept, goddamn dogs. You guys want to go to the dog park? Gonna get them riled up. But I'm standing right by the door. The heat's blowing in from the hot South Dakota August wind. I'm wearing two shirts. I'm wearing like a red polo and like an undershirt because I didn't want the chest pubes to play that day. Mm. And there was a couple girls at the customer service checkout. So I'm already a little nervous. Plus, I don't know if you've noticed, I'm not very good at math. And even if I have a fucking calculator in front of me, I'm just like, if you give me a $20 bill and like your tabs, like, or like your checkout thing is like $14.36, I would just stare blankly at you. Like, I don't know. I don't know how to make change. I've never had to worry about it. I usually pay with a card.
$5.64.
How dare you? But though all those factors played into me sitting at this cashier thing, just fucking pouring sweat to the point where one of the girls was like, "Are you okay?" And I was just like, "Ugh." And then thankfully some middle management checkout or middle management at Target was like, "We should not have Tyler as a cashier. Like we should maybe put him back near the frozen foods." This horse shit.
Yeah,
I'm not good in heat.
That like, I know that So I worked in retail quite a bit growing up, and a few different grocery stores, and then like a sporting goods retailer that I mentioned before. Now, just like looking from like outside perspective, like if you've never worked that job before, it appears easy because you kind of just hang out there, but standing on a tile floor, not moving for an 8 hour shift plus, that's a long fucking time to just be standing on the tile. And then not to mention, if no one has ever worked retail or customer service, either like in a grocery store or in a restaurant or even in a bank, like anytime you have to mess with people's food or their money, it's just a high stress situation. Like people get pissed off. They have to wait a little bit too long. Somebody brings you 10,000 coupons.
Yeah. You're panicking. You're stressed. They're stressed. It's too damn hot and you're freaking out and boom, you're sweating. And then that just adds to your anxiety because you're sweating. You don't want to be sweating, which makes you sweat more. And then you're just a fucking puddle and everyone notices. And you just try to survive in advance.
Well, and Target is a Karen hot zone too. So that doesn't help.
Yeah. That's why they kept me away from them. I fucking don't care, computer. Oh my God. Go away. All right. I fixed it. But the heat's not great. Currently my house, my air conditioning is set to 65. It's damn near chilly in here. Walking from outside into the TNT dojo is like entering the beer cooler at your gas station. It is cold. And the other part of TNT, the Tyler and Taylor dojo, is Taylor. He's a tiny, tiny man. He's a distance runner. There is no body fat on him. I don't know how he survives in this Arctic climate.
But he's good on him for playing ball.
Yeah, there is no playing ball. There is. I will sleep in front of the fucking thermostat. If it gets above 65 or 67, I'll bring the ruckus. I ain't sleeping in this hot bullshit.
Yeah,
I need to be cool.
We were I had like the thermostat was set to like 69 in here, obviously.
Nice.
But it wasn't keeping up. It was like 71 inside the house, just running constantly. But Lily had all the blinds open and the sun's just beating inside the house. And I had to start closing some stuff up.
What day was it? Was it last Friday? Last Friday I came home from work and I shut all the blinds and just cranked the AC down and was just like laying in the living room. And Taylor walked in and I'm sure he was like, oh, Tyler killed himself, because I was hunkered down. I was in just my zone. That's all I wanted. I hate the sun. I hate warm. Ugh. I'm not doing great.
So along like the whole like summer thing, we're grilling today and we're going to grill some brats. And first of all, do you like sauerkraut?
Yes and no, if that makes sense. I don't like sauerkraut on like brats, but I like sauerkraut on pizza.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. If you get a I've had this probably like five or six times. There was this place last year where I was at for work. It was me and another guy. And like right by our hotel was like a bar that did like crazy pizza specials. And like to the point where it was like a large pizza for like $5. And I just like, we were just like, fuck it. Let's just try a bunch of them. And we got one that was a meat lover's thin crust that had like sauerkraut as the base. It was fucking delicious. Like, it was so good that I literally ordered it like the next day. It was just like, nope, let's keep this rolling. And that's how I like sauerkraut.
That's wild. I've never had it on pizza. I like it on brats. The only problem is I was at the grocery store and I was picking up my ingredients. And can they not make a small can of fucking sauerkraut? You have to commit to a gallon of fucking sauerkraut. It's like, oh, well, I ain't gonna eat that whole thing, or else I'm gonna shit my fucking pants. Like, I just want enough to cover a couple brats.
Yeah,
and that's it.
It's like they're taunting you. It's like, if I go to the store, I can buy just a little bit of Miracle, like mayonnaise. It's like if they just jumped it up, it's like, well, I kind of need some mayonnaise. Oh, you need 3 gallons of it. Like, no, I don't. Yeah, they really do. It's not like I can't just buy a can of sauerkraut and just throw out half of it. They make you commit to 2 pounds of sauerkraut. That's just too much.
Yeah. They had a regular size can, you know, like your normal size cans. I don't know how many ounces it is, but
12, just
like 16. Your normal, yeah, just like your normal size can. But that's too much fucking sauerkraut. I need like a little one, like the like the little cans, like that the size of like oysters come in, or like the little cans that like
Vienna sausages.
Yeah, something about that size would play. That's about enough. A couple forkfuls is about all I need.
4 ounces of sauerkraut, and that's all. I don't need all of this. I don't know why sauerkraut's one of those things, like apparently they just have to sell it industrial sized.
Maybe it's just so cheap that it costs them more money to make a can than you put it inside of. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, there's gotta be some breakdown. I'm not even sure what fucking sauerkraut is.
That's a good point.
Cabbage?
I think so. Sounds right.
Again, sure. do not come to us for facts. What's that food you guys eat? Spaghetti.
I mean, I've put many things inside my body without knowing what the fuck it was.
So. Yeah. I also also threw on a couple dogs on the old grill. They were delightful. I went jalapeno dogs with some P-Jack cheese. A little bit of hot sauce. Whew. Delightful.
Kind of steering into the skid of shitting your pants.
I think at this point, everything's making me shit my pants, so I'm just going to eat whatever I want and then just wake up 6 times throughout the night with crippling stomach pain.
Oh, man.
I made 3 of them, and I went 2 no-bun, 1 bun. And I'm pretty sure the white bread is what's absolutely just eating my insides. But you know what? It was delicious. Also, pepper jack cheese on the hot dog. Whew, that's a move.
I've never done it on the hot dog, but pepper jack is definitely like, if not my favorite cheese, definitely the top three
favorite cheeses. Yeah, I'd say. I think I'm going to put P-Jack as probably 1 or 2 because it's an elite cheese. I'm sorry I'm not into all that fancy, stinky bull kind of cheese, but P-Jack. You throw a P-Jack, you throw a P-Jack on the charcuterie board, whew, your boy's eating a lot of meats with that P-Jack. Maybe a couple club crackers.
Do you venture as far to go habanero jack?
I have. There used to be – you used to be able to buy habanero jack, like string cheese. Mm. Yeah, your boy got into it for a while. Your boy got that nice heat and dairy. Yeah, that's how you make a strong body like this. It's probably why I sweat doing anything, but yeah, whatever.
Not to get away from our sweating and pooping and eating.
Sweating, pooping, and cheese talk.
I do have a few things on my list. Did you watch the UFC fights last week?
I did. I watched probably 4 of them. Okay. I was taking a little nap.
Yeah, I watched a couple of them. They were actually some pretty good fights. I saw the recap. Yeah. I didn't see it the night of, but I watched it like the day after.
Yeah, I was
ESPN 2.
I would say I was watching them and I was sending you snaps because I was like, God damn, we got some brawls going on.
I wanted to talk about the Gilbert Burns and Tyron Woodley fight. I don't know how I didn't know who Gilbert Burns was, but I think his record was what? He's 19-3.
Yeah, he kind of came out of nowhere for me too.
Yeah, I mean he's been around for a long time. He the last few fights that he's taken has been on like short notice where they like needed somebody and he's like, yep, nope, I'm in. And then he's won those fights and then he slowly just won and they were telling the story about like kind of how he got into jujitsu and got into MMA stuff. Like when he was a little kid, his father owned like a car repair shop, and I guess like he brought in his car and there was like a gi in the back seat, and like I guess Gilbert and his brother like started like playing around with it. We're like fucking around with it, and then the guy's like, "Oh, I'll trade you 3 months of jiu-jitsu training for your kids. You know, if you fix my car for free." The dad's like, "Okay," and then I guess they just fucking ran with it after that, which is kind of a crazy story.
Yeah, that is nuts. Why did that never happen to me as a child? Because I would have played, if someone would have gave like 6-year-old Tyler a fucking gi, I would have been like, well, this is the only thing I want to do for the rest of my life.
Yeah, they probably couldn't peel the Nintendo controller away from my hand long enough for me to do that at the time. But yeah, it's a cool story. I mean, the guy's a badass. His brother is also a fighter. Yeah, like, you know, he 2011, he was a gold medalist in the 2011 World Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu Championship.
Damn.
He won a bronze in 2015 at the Abu Dhabi Submission Wrestling Championship. I mean,
dude, that'd be so cool. Like, even just like, that sounds like something they like make up in like a bad, like never back down. They're just like, you go to the Abu Dhabi Submission Games. That sounds so cool. I bet there's like Asian dudes smoking cigarettes being like, no. And they're just betting on it. Oh, man, that sounds awesome. That's what I want to do.
Dude, I mean, the welterweight division is, you know, pretty stacked with people. But that Usman-Gilbert Burns fight is
– yeah.
It's going to be fun to watch. Gilbert's fucking good. Cause Tyron Woodley isn't at, I know like he, you know, kind of had a little bit of time off and he's like trying to get back into it and everything, but
he's like, he's a very well-known name. Like casual fans know the name Tyron Woodley. Like he's very, former very champion, good.
Defended his title for a long time. He's got like one punch knockout strength as a welterweight. He's got tree trunks for thighs. Like he's very, very fucking explosive. He was pretty sure Tyron Woodley was like a gold medalist wrestler, you know, very decorated wrestler. I mean, he's a hell of a fighter, and Gilbert Burns put on a clinic more or less. Like,
I want to say
well in that fight.
One of Woodley's fights a couple of years ago, they did like the, you know, pre-fight, like showing kind of what he like did to work out. And I want to say he was working out for like 8 hours a day. And like, they were like showing him like doing like feats of strength. And him just doing like multiple backflips, like just standing backflips, just like, yep, I can do this. Just a freak athlete. And it does kind of like, one of the things about UFC that kind of sucks is like, but you usually by the time that someone gets kind of big enough to be like, holy shit, they're famous as fuck, they usually end up getting murdered by some unknown guy in the ring. And that, I mean, because the more fights you have to fight to get famous, the more damage you take. The old Chuck Liddell route, and next thing you know, you're just getting fucking pummeled. I mean, it happens to Chuck Liddell, BJ Penn, fucking Uriah Faber. All these guys, they get good enough, and then they get dead. And then, I mean, look at – I mean, how many famous heavyweights do we – like, I mean, famous, like, light heavyweights that, like, we grew up with that – I mean, Tito Ortiz, Randy Couture, I mean, all these big names – and then the last like 5 fights of their career, they just get murdered. And that's, I feel like that's kind of the route that Tyron Woodley's on, where it's just like, yep, you used to be fucking awesome, but you're a little old. Father Time's undefeated, and now you get slept.
Yeah, I think in the welterweight division, I think Masvidal and Nate Diaz might fight. Again, for like the bad motherfucker or baddest motherfucker, the BMF belt again,
which I'm okay with, which I am very okay with.
Yeah, big time. And then obviously, like after seeing like Gilbert's his little backstory and his lead up and like looking at everything and like seeing him as like a fighter and, you know, his record and everything, I'm excited to see him and Usman. fight for the championship belt for welterweight, because it's much deserved for Gilbert. And now that he beat Tyron Woodley, he's the number one contender. So unless they try to do like a Colby Covington Burns fight, it's got to be Usman. I mean, it's time for Gilbert literally to get his chance to fight, because I think that might have been his first main event fight. Was just this one last week?
Yeah, if I'm not mistaken. I knew he was kind of one of those, like, you would see him on the card and you'd be like, oh, all right. But yeah, I did not realize that he was like, holy shit, he's actually doing incredible.
Mm-hmm.
Which was, because I kind of thought Woodley was just going to walk through him. And then
I did too.
As soon as I started to do a little bit of research, I was like, oh, fuck.
Yep. So he definitely deserves his chance at the title. So hopefully they make that happen sooner than later.
Do you have the card pulled up?
I do not. I can try to pull it up quickly.
I was going to say, I didn't have – for some reason, it wouldn't let me pull it up on ESPN, because there was a couple fights that I wanted to talk about. There was the ladies fight with – I can't remember either of their names.
Was it the Mackenzie Dern and Hannah Cyphers?
Was that the one where, like, did Mackenzie Dern win?
Yes, she did. There was also the I don't remember. I didn't see the so I was watching part of. I don't know. I can't remember. I was watching part of this, and then there was like a news break on. I was watching something else. Never mind. I don't know what I'm talking about. But the prelims, the Caitlin Chukagan versus the Antonina Shevchenko.
They call her like blonde fighter or something.
Yes. Yeah, that was the one. That was a ass whooping. So Caitlin Chukagan, I think she fought the other Shevchenko sister, and the other Shevchenko sister just took it to Chukagan. And this fight, Chukagan just absolutely dominated Shevchenko big time. Just
hurt. Yeah, there was that one. There was one of them where, God, I know the chick was wearing yellow. I cannot remember her name. But, like, she was pregnant, like, 4 months ago. And then she fought, and she
– That's Dern, I think.
Was that Dern?
Yeah. Because she was – I saw that, too, when they were talking about it. She was, like, 3 months pregnant. Or she was pregnant 3 months later, came back and like fought. Won, I think.
Yeah, that was nuts. Because I was just like, they were saying that, and I was just like, holy shit. If I gave birth, which I probably never will unless science advances a lot, and I choose to do so because it's my body, I'm probably sitting on it for like a year. I'm certainly not. I'm not in fight shape in 3 months. That's for goddamn sure.
Well, and I think that was her first kid, being a married man that has had a wife that's had two kids, just outside perspective looking in, your body does a lot of fucking crazy shit to give birth, to prepare, and then to give birth to a kid, and then like the postpartum stuff, like after, like your body is all over the fucking place. Hormones are all over the place. Like your body is essentially tore up from, you know, pushing a child through, you know, but you know, when you dilate to 10 millimeters at the end, that is still not big enough to pass like a 7 or 8 pound baby. Like there's a lot of ripping and tearing and things that are going on down there. So to come back and fight 3 months after
and then win.
That's fucking nuts.
Yeah, that was crazy to me. Because she won in, like, dominating fashion, too. I want to say she knee – it was something with a knee, like a knee submission, like a knee lock.
Oh, yeah.
And then, like, in, like, the first round, she's just like, boom, I have it. Like, you're done.
Yeah, she – 2 minutes, 36 seconds in the first round, submission, beating Hannah Cyphers. That was performance of the night. or they tied performance of the night with the main event with Tyron Woodley and Gilbert Burns.
Yeah, there was that one. That one was crazy. And then this one, I was in the middle of – the guy's name is Spike Albrecht. Does that pop up on there?
Carlisle?
Spike Carlisle. Spike Albrecht might be the bad guy from Little Giants.
I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah, but that Spike Carlisle guy, he came out, first of all, he's a pale dude with red hair with cornrows. So I immediately was like, oh, Conor McGregor. And the announcers, which DC, still looking fat as hell, looking real thick. But, they were talking. They're like, this guy, all he wants to do is get fight of the night bonuses. He's fucking nuts. He's swinging for the fences on everything. And literally, he comes out for, a flying knee, right away. He is beating the shit out of this other dude. And he's, throwing crazy, crazy combinations. At one point, the spike was on top, and he was kind of ground and pounding whatever his opponent's name was. And his opponent locked onto his arm, and the spike guy, fucking picked him up with one arm and slammed him. And I was literally in the midst of snapping you to be like, holy shit, this spike dude's legit. Immediately gassed out and got his ass kicked. just immediately. In the 11 seconds it took for me to get my phone out to be like, dude, this guy's going to be awesome. Just fucking dead. it was so embarrassing. That's why I should not be a UFC announcer, because I've been like, well, he's the greatest fighter of all time. Nope. Turns out you have to have a little bit of cardio.
Yeah. Billy Quarantillo?
Quarantillo, yeah, something like that.
Beat him, yeah.
I think it was in the third round.
Yep. They said it went the distance, so it was a decision.
Yeah. Yeah, no, but it was, I think, in the last 20 seconds of the third round, because this spike guy, literally arms down, walking forward, just a zombie, and that Castanello guy, whatever.
Quarantillo.
Quarantillo. That Quarantillo guy just teed off on his face. If that fight would have went another 30 seconds, he wins by knockout. It was very, very. It was just fun to watch. That was one of the last fights I watched live. The other ones I caught up on the next day. But that was fun to watch. I wish that spike guy was better.
We're gonna get the fights here for Saturday for the Amanda Nunes. It is 250. Yeah, UFC 250. Yeah. I was looking through the card. I honestly, besides Nunes, her fight, I guess I know of Cody Garbrandt, but
yeah,
don't really know who he's fighting, and I don't really recognize a lot of people on the card. It's crazy how out of touch with UFC I've become. I don't know any of these fucking people anymore.
I was gonna say there was a point a couple years ago where it's I was recognizing prelim fighters,
mm-hmm.
and now it's one of those things where they're I know it's on the day before. I'm like, oh shit, the UFC. And then I watch it and it's just I really enjoy this. And then I forget about it for 4 days.
Yeah. So open invite, I guess, if you want to come. I know you probably have plans, but a few of us are going to be over here and watch the fights. So.
Bold of you assume I make plans on the weekend. Mostly I just show up places and cause a scene. And yeah. I'm really good at that. That does transition nicely into the old John Jones talk.
Oh, yeah.
Because our friend John Jones, losing his fucking mind. He's went insane. I'm starting to think getting punched in the head's a bad fucking career choice for your sanity.
Yeah. I mean, I can kind of understand a little bit of the beef between him and Dana. So
oh, yeah, 100%.
From my understanding, a little bit of research and a little bit of articles and some of the interviews and videos that I've watched, essentially John Jones wants to go up to heavyweight to fight Ngannou, but because his contract was locked in as a light heavyweight, that he wants to reevaluate the contract and get paid more money. I believe he's currently
five million a fight.
Fight, which I believe is the third highest, like between Khabib and Conor.
Conor, yeah.
And I think John is number three. And he mentioned that he didn't need to get paid Wilder money to fight, which I believe was $30 million.
$30 million. Yep.
So I'm assuming he's wanting somewhere in the middle between seven to thirty. I don't know if there was a number mentioned.
I think I read that he wanted $15 million. Mm. I think he said he came out and he was like, I think like one of his tweets said, "I'm not trying to make Deontay Wilder money. I'm trying to make half of Deontay Wilder's money," which would put that at $15 million, which I don't think you're going to get that, John. Sorry, bud.
And I could be wrong, but I think so. From my understanding of how some of these have been structured, it's like you get a purse, and your purse is that $5 million that he was getting per fight.
Yep.
But then you also make a percentage or a certain amount of the pay-per-view. So if the pay-per-view sales are good, which most John Jones pay-per-views would be good, and you get some sort of kickback or a percentage of sales on that.
Yeah, I think it's a percentage. I want to say I think that's why Khabib and Conor made so much, was because I think they both had negotiated in there. I know Conor makes a huge chunk of the pay-per-views, because I do believe Conor McGregor is probably the top draw of the UFC. Everyone wants to watch Conor McGregor fight. That's what makes him Conor McGregor. He's a fucking champion trash talker who normally puts someone to sleep with his fists, which people seem to be into.
Right. Yeah. So, you know, because John wants to make that fight happen, but he wants to get paid more money to go up to heavyweight and renegotiate his contract, and Dana's pretty much like not wavering, but then John said something about how Dana is like tarnishing his name or whatever, and then Dana's like, "Hey, buddy, you've done a pretty good job of tarnishing your name on your own."
That one made me laugh so much. Like,
you know what? Like, I do think that John Jones is pretty cerebral, and he's pretty like, most of the time when he says shit, as wild and crazy as it is, he's usually in the right. But in that instance, you kind of got him there. when you're pissing hot, you can't stop drinking and driving with guns, shooting guns, whilst intoxicated. Come on, that, man.
Yeah, that one, I like to think that, like, I feel like most celebrities have, like, publicists. There we go. Whew. It's goddamn heat, am I right?
You got it.
But I feel like most of the times they're not in charge of like their own social media. And I feel like John Jones is in charge. Like, he's just like, he has his own password. Yes. He tweeted that, and his publicist was just like, "No, please, God, no. Don't talk about tarnishing legacies. Please. Please don't do that, John." Yeah, that was just from everything that I was reading and stuff, because John Jones probably is my favorite fighter of all time. I consider John Jones probably the best UFC fighter of all time.
I would agree.
And like, if aliens invaded Earth tomorrow and they're like, "Put your champion against ours," I think we should probably put John Jones in there.
Yeah, and Steven Seagal, I think.
Yeah, well, obviously Steven Seagal. Steven Seagal is probably the alien he has to fight. Or he's certainly going to be a Mortal Kombat style ref. But there was John Jones, fuck, man. Do not give up your goddamn title. Just fight in the goddamn UFC. Like, quit pissing off Dana White.
I don't know. Like, he more or less said that he's willing to sit out or, you know, vacate his title because, and then force a contract renegotiation to get him back. And I mean, in times like this, when sports are so far and few between, granted, there's things are starting to come back. There's plans in motion to start to bring back like things with the NBA potentially, which seems fairly bleak, but the, like the NHL, the MLB stuff,
major, you know, I see it. Just from what I read, just because I do have this written down, and I did a little bit of research into it, because it sounds like Major League Baseball is kind of like they're debating over pay right now.
Yeah, there might be a lockout even, huh?
Yeah, it sounds like the NBA is going to start July 31st. The finals will be at the beginning of October. They're going to do a – I think it's 16 teams. 16 teams are going to do a shortened regular season – some play-in games, and then the playoffs, then the finals. Which I wanted to talk about. Like, I don't know if I'm a pretty big NBA guy, and that really does interest me. I really do like watching, especially like playoff basketball. That really does interest me. And I think there's going to be a lot of players like who are coming back who are fucking ready for war. Like LeBron James is going to be fucking rested. There's a real solid chance he plays every minute of every game, and transcends to the greatest basketball player of all time.
No, that'll be cool to see. I heard there, I don't have the specifics, but I remember like a shortened season playoff, different, like a playing series throughout a tournament style playoff type of thing for like hockey too. And they were talking about doing it in like two places.
Yep, and I think like LA and like Toronto or something like that, I think is what I saw.
Yeah, because I heard that they started out with like a list of places. Like I think there was like Pittsburgh, a few other places. But yeah, I don't know if they. And I heard Toronto and you say LA and then Vegas, I think was another one. But yeah. So hopefully that all works out too.
I'm very interested.
Yeah, and aside from like those things that are like progressing, the UFC has really been, you know, like really one of the only sports that we've been able to really watch. So being that John Jones is a big draw, it would be shitty, you know, for him to like walk away or, you know, vacate his title and not fight again, especially in this time. I mean, as a selfish sports fan, I don't want that to happen. Which I do believe there is, you know, to bump up to heavyweight, to have the more risk to fight a larger, stronger opponent,
knockout artist,
you know, like potentially, you know, putting your health more at risk being in a larger weight class. Like I understand that, you know, obviously when he wrote that contract, this was a contract for light heavyweight, not for heavyweight. So I think it's valid. And I think that Dana was willing to negotiate to a point, and I just don't think that they're there. So it would be a shame if they can't work it out. But
I like you said, as a selfish sports fan, I'm going to be very sad if I never see John Jones fight again. And I, you know, Dana White is a fucking, he's a salesman. He wants to do this. Who knows if this isn't all a little bit of bluster? Who knows if this isn't a way to get John Jones just back in the spotlight? I hope it is. But I also, on the other hand, do kind of believe that John Jones, I think he thinks of himself as I think he's a little too big for his britches, which is dumb to say as the best UFC fighter of all time. But like, he is a little bit, I think he's overselling his draw a little bit, because there's a lot of people that do not like John Jones. Mm-hmm. There is a healthy portion of America that's just like, who the fuck's John Jones? Like, if I ask my mom who Conor McGregor is, my mom knows who Conor McGregor is. If I ask my mom who John Jones is, she has no fucking clue. And she has bought me John Jones clothing before.
Yeah, hopefully they can figure that out, because Ngannou Jones fight at heavyweight would be awesome. And then that kind of opens up the door to John being heavyweight, and being that Cormier's fat ass is not going to get back down to light heavyweight ever, I don't think. So then he'll be right there, and then I would like to see that fight again.
Maybe they're going to let Cormier do fucking gastric bypass He is looking a lot girthier. And goddamn quarantine got us all.
Yeah, definitely can relate to that.
It was real nice last year, like working outside like 14 hours a day, because like I could go to like bars and stuff and it would be like 75 degrees and I could just stand there and not sweat. And now that I am a soft office puppy that doesn't work outside anymore, dude, I'm dying. Like we were at an outdoor bar on Saturday and I was like sitting there like, oh, can I get a glass of water? Oh, I just need maybe an ice wrap. Someone just missed me.
Did you see last week the SpaceX, the Crew Dragon spacecraft?
Yep.
That the SpaceX that Elon Musk was involved with, that two-man the Crew Dragon was like it was a two-man spacecraft and they docked at the space station on Sunday.
Yep. First Americans launched from America in I think like 12 years or something like that,
which is 10 years maybe. Which is crazy to think about. And I guess this is where my mind goes, is that like,
oh, you're crackling so bad, bud.
Oh yeah?
Yeah.
Really bad?
Really bad.
I wonder what's causing that. Is it better now?
It is better now.
Okay. I wonder, still crackling?
Not as bad. It got real bad there for like a minute.
I wonder what the fuck. All right. Anywho.
Push past.
What's crazy to me is that like we haven't docked anything to the space station in years. And it's like to make something here on Earth that, you know, I don't know if there's a standard way to dock to the fucking station, but to build something perfectly so that it, you know, it connects and they knew exactly how to, you know, fabricate it and build it. It's just kind of, it's
mind blowing.
Yeah. It's probably something stupid to think about, but I guess when you got like fucking blueprints and scans and, you know, whatever, you got all the stuff to build it, but it's just crazy that you can build something that perfectly can dock and connect to the space station. But
I watched this. I watched them take off. I was at Applebee's. I was at Applebee's enjoying some mozzarella sticks when it went off. And it was one of those things where I'm sitting there like in an Applebee's drinking a dollar Long Island iced tea, eating mozzarella sticks, being like, dude, space is fucking crazy. Because it is nuts. They literally, a private company built a rocket that launched American astronauts for the first time in a decade. And they launched them into space and they could dock perfectly in space using fucking, I'm assuming, math that I will never comprehend. And it just fits perfectly. Like, yeah. Holy shit.
Yeah, that was kind of my takeaway. Like, and what that was, we haven't done that in, fuck, I closed the article because I think there was a video buffering. I think that's what's fucking up my sound. But yeah, you know, had been however long since we've done that, and now it proves that, like, you know, Elon Musk's SpaceX venture somewhat legitimate. You know, like, you know, the space station hovers like 200, 250 miles above the Earth or something like that.
Dude.
So, I mean, it's not like we went to the moon, but still.
We went, yeah. It proves we could go back. Also, shut up, Brad. We did go to the moon. We did go to the fucking moon. I know you're a goddamn we didn't go to a moon guy. And if you're listening and you don't believe we went to the moon, fight me. Fight me in the fucking streets. We went to the goddamn moon.
I didn't realize that Brad was such a conspiracy theorist guy. He's really come full circle on that as of late. Yeah. He's been hitting me with the YouTube videos and the articles, and now he's our conspiracy theorist friend. Yeah. So that's nice.
There was we were at the library sometime last year. And I damn near fought Brad because we were arguing over if we went to the moon or not. I was pissed. And like the entire time he's just like, dude, just gotta watch the videos. I'm like, fuck your videos, we went to the fucking moon. Just getting agitated at a bar. Just like, what, sir, why'd you get in a fight with one of your best friends? It was like, fucking moon.
Yeah, if you can edit a good YouTube video, you can convince Brad of anything. That's a fact.
Yeah, which we gotta start working on our Brad give us hundreds of thousands of dollars YouTube video.
I'll write that on my list.
Yeah, give all your money to your friends who have a podcast. Ooh, I'm hoping he listens to this when he falls asleep. I'm gonna incept Brad.
So. After watching like the Last Dance docuseries and then it got me in the vein of watching sports documentaries, and the documentary Lance about Lance Armstrong,
yep,
came out. And like the one thing I noticed, you know, the Last Dance is that, like I'm a Michael Jordan fan. Like I think he's the greatest of all time. I do think that LeBron playing has the potential to, you know, keep putting up records and,
yep,
you know, further that debate. But, you know, you can have the LeBron Jordan debate till the fucking end of time. They're crackling
so much crackle, like an incredible amount of crackle. I could barely hear you crackle.
Son of a bitch. Yeah. I don't know what the fuck is going on. We'll have to figure something out. Anyways, what I was trying to get at was that one thing that I took away from the Last Dance was that Jordan is kind of a dick. And watching this Lance documentary about Lance Armstrong, I think Lance Armstrong is a larger dick.
Dick. Oh yeah. Jordan. That's like, I know the quote that MJ had before like the Last Dance came out is he was just like, this documentary is going to make people think I'm a way bigger asshole than they already do. And the thing that I took away from this Lance Armstrong one was like, Lance Armstrong is a way bigger fucking dick, because he looks like an asshole this entire goddamn time.
Yeah. Yep.
Like hard.
Like they were, the lady that was doing the interview with him in a majority of the documentary, when she was like talking to him, she kept having to keep convincing him that, like, Lance, you already admitted that you're wrong. Like, just expand upon it. He's like, whoa. And he was like, yeah, really struggling with like not being an asshole about everything.
Which I kind of understood where he was coming from there, because like, yeah, he admitted he was wrong, but he kind of did it in like that roundabout like, yeah, I guess I'm wrong. And it's like, I wouldn't have admitted if I was wrong if you guys weren't forcing me to. And I think he's convinced himself of his own legend in his head, which he has done. Like, he did a shitload for cancer research. I mean, there wasn't a single person on the world that didn't have a fucking Livestrong bracelet. Mm-hmm. And even if like $1 a piece went to the fucking cancer research, that's like $80 quintillion for fucking cancer research. But you're a fucking dickhead, dude. Like, him roasting. Did you see that part where you just roasted Floyd Landis?
Yeah, he went after Floyd Landis like really fucking hard. Yeah. Because, and honestly, like, so watching the part about Floyd Landis, when Floyd Landis won the Tour de France, was it the year after or 2 years after Lance Armstrong retired for
the
first time?
Yeah, it was something like that. I think it might have been the next year.
Because Lance was like, no American will win the Tour de France if it's not me. Yeah. And then Floyd won, but then And I think because Floyd won, there was a little bit of a probe that got put into him that might have been kind of enforced by Lance Armstrong to prove that he was doping.
Which fucked Lance Armstrong.
And once he exposed that Floyd was doping, the funny thing about it was, okay, so from what I learned in the documentary was Floyd Landis was doping, but everybody else had been doping like the entire time. Any of the top riders were essentially all involved with cocaine, steroids, testosterone, HGH, you name it.
It was a nice weekend.
So Floyd Landis got in trouble after he won the Tour de France, which I believe he got probed because Lance Armstrong went after him. Because of that, Floyd Landis took it on the chin for 2 years and stayed quiet, didn't rat anybody out, didn't say a word. At the end of his 2 years, he was like, hey, can I come back? And they're like, ooh, no.
Sorry, no,
you're nuclear. You know, everybody's going to be looking into us if you come back. Like, we just can't have it. And he's like, what the fuck? He's like, you know, I pretty much took this on the chin and, you know, dealt with it for 2 years.
Help me, guys.
Protected the brand. And now you guys are just selling me out. Like, you're not going to help. Like, he's pretty much, his career was over. And he's like, all right, well, fuck it. I'm going to tell everybody about everything now. And that was eventually what led to, like, if Floyd Landis hadn't come forward and released all that stuff, we probably wouldn't know about Lance Armstrong, you know, doping and taking all the steroids and HGH and all that shit.
That was kind of something that, like, I feel like everyone just knew that, like, if you were a top bicycle rider, like, you were just doping. Like, you just were. It just was crazy to me. It's like the Barry Bonds thing where, like, Barry Bonds already had a Hall of Fame career. Then he was like, then he started using steroids and he became the greatest home run hitter of all time. Like, I think Lance Armstrong was so fucking good at biking. And then you mixed in the doping. Cause like there was clips that I saw where like the person who like was in second place behind Lance Armstrong, like Lance Armstrong would like slow down to like talk shit to that guy and then just ride the fuck away from him. And like, it's like, holy shit, like, you're significantly better than us. If everyone was doping, but you still won and everyone was doping, I mean, I guess that kind of, like, levels the playing field.
Well, and don't get me wrong, like, doping or not, to complete the Tour de France and to win consecutively over and over and over again, like, it's still fucking a feat.
Yeah, still nuts.
But for the guys that were, you know, way outside of the top 10 that were running the race, that weren't doping, that were legitimate, like, I understand where they're coming from. But the one thing I did take away from, like, a lot of the people they interviewed, they're like, all like, yeah, we were all pretty much fucking doing it. But then, and then a lot of the guys that they did interview also, they're still like, Lance was doping. Yeah, Lance, you know, that was cheating. But they were still, you know, they still said that, you know, he was still a hell of an athlete.
He was still really, really good.
They still look at it as those were deserved, even though he was cheating.
I think this is just something that I kind of remember off the top of my head. I want to say the year Floyd Landis won, because they keep those tests for like, they test those, like, your tests for like years afterwards, you know, because like, you know, hopefully you don't have anything that can beat our tests. But I want to say like, the year Floyd Landis won, they kept testing, and they, like, if they disqualified everyone that got caught doping, like, the guy that got, like, 57th place would have won the Tour de France. So, it's like, there's at least the top 50 right there that were doping. Like, everyone was on something.
Well, and the crazy thing about it is, like, everybody knows who Lance Armstrong is. You know, that's just a name that everybody knows.
Yeah.
What's crazy is, like, once all this stuff happened or whatever, and not to take away from anything that Lance did for, like, the Cancer to Live Strong, you know, partnering with Nike and doing that, because he helped a lot. Like, he did a lot of good things.
But he did.
But he was a shitty person. Cheated also.
Yeah, it'd be like if Hitler came back and cured AIDS. It's like thanks for curing AIDS. You're still a fucking cunt.
I don't think Lance Armstrong's quite on the Hitler scale, but I see where you're going with that.
Yeah. Potato, potato.
But it's like, now, I couldn't tell you who fucking won the Tour de France, nor do I care, you know? And I don't think anybody else does either. Like, Lance put cycling on the map, and it's just crazy how much pull he had with, like, the cycling association or whatever the fuck it was.
Yeah.
Because he was the guy. He was the face of, like, the
Lance Armstrong was fucking everywhere. Like, everywhere. Lance Armstrong was on that, like, Tiger Woods, Michael Jordan, like, Derek Jeter, Dale Earnhardt. Like, he was the face of that fucking – of that stuff. And he made people care about it. Yeah, mm-hmm. Like, I know Lance Armstrong's accomplishments. I couldn't tell you if the Tour de France – I couldn't tell you when it happens. Is it every year? Is it every fucking 3 years? I have no fucking clue.
Is it in France?
I don't know. Yeah, I have no fucking clue. I was saying, is it called the Tour de France, but it takes place in Berlin? I have, once again, no fucking idea. But Lance Armstrong made it what it was. And it, the fact that he just looks so fucking bad is just killer. It just sucks for cycling. I'm sure cycling will still be popular with the fucking 80 fans. Mostly French people, I'm assuming. Bon oui, ride the bicycle. But like it sucks that Lance Armstrong sucks so much. Like, yeah. I do understand to like be like that alpha predator athlete, you do have to have that mindset of like, yeah, everyone else fucking sucks. I'm the best. Like, no one can fucking touch me. And that's kind of what puts them into that realm. Like, no one will outwork me. Everyone else is a piece of shit. I mean, you saw during The Last Dance, too, that MJ basically was like, yeah, I'm a fucking psychopath. Yep. And it just sucks that you can't have one of those, like, top athletes who's just like, yeah, I'm actually a pretty decent human. Because you just can't have that. You can't be, like, a cool person and be, like, the top athlete. Because that they just do not fucking mesh.
Yeah. Yeah, that was my big takeaway from the Lance. Yeah, and I when they interviewed him, he was like, and it, like just when they showed like the pictures of Floyd, like obviously like when he was cycling, he looked like a cyclist, but when they interviewed him, he just looked like a normal dude.
Normal dude, yeah. That's what it's so crazy that like I've seen the pictures of like the cyclist's legs after they do like the mountain runs in the Tour de France, where they go like they pedal up crazy mountains and they fly around, and it's like their legs are so vascular because they're pumping crazy amounts of other people's bloods through their system apparently. But like it is nuts. Like those guys are freaks, and it just sucks that you have to kind of like you have to dope to be the best. Which I do not blame you. I firmly believe that most professional athletes are on something, on a level of steroid. Like, sorry, you don't – like NFL players, they're probably all on something. NBA players are probably all on something. Baseball players are probably all on something. Professional wrestlers, I think they do steroids. I don't want to ruin anything for anyone, but I think they do steroids.
Yeah.
I think Dwayne The Rock Johnson is on steroids.
Ooh. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like probably. You don't be 50 years old in that size.
I will say, so we saw the video of the Titan Games thing with Joe Thomas when he won. I actually watched – there was attempting to watch the whole thing, and it got broken into for, like, news coverage of the riots and stuff, obviously. But Joe Thomas was like when he finished when he won or whatever, he came over and he was like he was pretty gassed, you know, from running the thing. And like The Rock came over and like he's like, let me help you, and he's like taking his helmet off for him or whatever. When Joe Thomas was standing next to The Rock, Joe Thomas is still a large motherfucker. Like compared to The Rock, like he like you know, assuming to, you know, The Rock towering over everybody and like just looking massive compared to everyone. Yeah. But like him and Joe Thomas were like similar. I mean, not as, you know, he wasn't as broad and as bulky as The Rock anymore. But Joe Thomas is still a very fucking large man. Yeah. And now he's like fucking shredded.
Yeah. Freak athlete. That it's always crazy. Cause I think they say The Rock is like 6'5". And I think like with like Hollywood inflation and shit like that, he's probably like 6'2", 6'3". Joe Thomas is legit. I mean, combine measurements. Joe Thomas is legit 6'6", and probably like a built 260 right now. Like built. Like absolute monster built.
Yeah. I watching him pull that, I don't know if it was like 200 pounds or whatever it was, like this ball and chain thing, and just pull, like throw it over his shoulder and drag it across the ring. Like, yeah, he's, or he, when part of the competition, when he's like going up and you have to like more or less pick up like this bag and it's like 200 pounds and then walk it up an incline, and he just grabbed that. And then there's like a portion where like he gets to this spot where you have to like pull these like chain weight things off of this post.
Yeah.
And like Joe Thomas was going so fast that the announcer couldn't keep up to like each step of things that he was doing. They were trying to explain what he was doing. And like before they could explain how heavy, like I guess these weights were like 120 pounds a piece, and he was just picking them off, just tossing them off the side. Like they were nothing.
It's like, yeah, for Joe Thomas looks easy. For a normal person, it would literally crush your spine. Yeah. Like, this is totally dumb, but like today I used a pallet jack to lift up 36 5-gallon boxes, and I had to like pull them like 6 feet. And then there was like literally like a 3-inch like hill I had to go up. I had to get 3 fucking runs at it. Like, I finally got it up there, but it fucking took every ounce of energy I had. Joe Thomas would have literally just like pushed it with one arm. And I am not a tiny cat. And I had the legs pumping. Oh, dude, I was ready for war.
Oh, man.
But other than that, I got nothing else.
Yeah, that brings me to the end of my list as well. I'll try to start prepping some stuff for this Thursday. Week. Also looking into that Dungeons and Dragons thing, need to reach out to you and Freet and whoever our fourth is going to be and try to pin down a time. Dude, was thinking about Sunday, but we'll see if that works out. I haven't reached out to the guy yet to try to figure out when we can do that, but looking forward to that.
Yeah, I was gonna say I'm very excited for that. I've been addicted to Oregon Trail this entire time, and I feel like Dungeons & Dragons is going to be like advanced Oregon Trail for me.
Yeah, that'll translate well.
Except I can keep trying to kill Freet.
All righty. Well,
but, stay safe out there, folks. It's a crazy fucking world. You know, I'm not going to get into it, but just stay safe.
Yep.
Protect you and yours, and also protect other people you can't, that don't have a voice.
Exactly. Yep. But yeah, I guess that does it for episode 20.
Episode 20 is in the books. Hugs and kisses on my cats and kittens.
XOXO.
Bye.
See ya.